Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Every Creeping Thing by Richard Conniff, narrated by Richard M. Davidson. This work is copyrighted 1998 by Richard Conniff. This recording is copyrighted 2000 by Recorded Books. Richard Conniff has written about natural history and American life for such magazines as the Atlantic Monthly, Discover, Smithsonian, National Geographic, and Time, and is a television writer and producer for National Geographic and the Discovery Channel. Recorded Books fans will remember his earlier jaunt into the weird world of animals from his previous volume, Spineless Wonders. In July of 2000, the entertaining and offbeat author made the journey from his home in Connecticut to the New York recording studios of Recorded Books, where we had a chance to talk with him about his work. You will find that interview at the end of the book. In this latest offering, Every Creeping Thing, Richard Conniff focuses on some of the least huggable members of the animal world. Porcupines, snapping turtles, cormorants, bats, mice, moles. Through their lives, we are introduced to some of the strangest behaviors on Earth. And now, Every Creeping Thing.
Introduction. Healthy Terror. One evening, last summer, in a stand of trees beside a floodplain in Botswana, a friend and I were grilling skewered meat over an open fire. A pride of 16 lions was living somewhere off to the east of our camp, and another pride of 22 lions to the west, and one night a leopard wandered past, making a low, growling sound like a ripsaw slowly notching through somebody's thigh bone. An elephant had lately been chasing people in the neighborhood with a high, outraged trumpeting that I could hear with the hairs on the back of my neck. It was, of course, unnerving to live among all this wildlife, protected at night by nothing more than a layer of rip-stop nylon, but it was also exhilarating. Looking out across the grassy floodplain, where 10-foot-tall termite mounds pointed like monumental fingers to the sky, I could imagine what it might have been like to be a hunter-gatherer at a time not so far in the past, anywhere in the world, in a wilderness now surely vanished. We squatted by the fire, watching the flames lick at the charred corners of the meat. It was pork satay, lest this all seem a little too primitive, and the conversation turned to what my friend termed Pleistocene memories. He'd heard a lecture once theorizing about the evolutionary roots of our aesthetic sensibilities. We love lawns, to cite the most familiar example, apparently because short grass made it easier for our forebears to see snakes approaching. We love clean, polished surfaces because they suggest the proximity of water. This same touching confusion may also trouble animals. Like us, female dragonflies sometimes get shiny cars and reproduction mixed up. They hover expectantly over a car and fire their eggs down onto the polished hood, mistaking it for the surface of a pond. We tend to respond positively to a certain branchy tree shape because it stirs up comforting genetic memories of the sort of tree in which our simian forebears roosted at night for safety from predators. The embers gyred up toward the treetops, and with them went my thoughts, in which the lives of people and animals were twined together in an endlessly varied dance of fear, worship, curiosity, delight. Among other things, I found myself thinking about Gaius Julius Solinus. Regarding the third or possibly fourth most influential writer of natural history ever produced by Western civilization, almost nothing is known, except that he was a systematic plagiarist and suffered from an inordinate fondness for monsters. Classicists have generally surmised from close readings of the text that Gaius Julius Solinus was a Roman, or anyway a citizen of the Roman Empire, who cobbled together his Collectania Rerum Memorabilium, collection of remarkable facts, sometime between A.D. 220 and 280. It was a work of about 200 pages, mostly stolen from the Roman encyclopedist Pliny, and when modern critics try to characterize it, words like wretched and trivial spring to mind. It's a source of understandable consternation for these critics to add that Salinas, nonetheless, helped shape European ideas about nature and the world at large for more than 1,000 years. So when I came across his work, not long ago, in the course of preparing this book, Salinas naturally intrigued me. I browsed through his remarkable facts with wonder at how shamelessly he distorted the natural world. The deeply gratifying sensation of disdain for our primitive forebears welled up within me. Here was the perfect model of everything a natural history writer should not be. But I must confess that I also continued to read, and with a sort of guilty fascination otherwise reserved for tabloid newspaper headlines in the supermarket checkout line. You know the sort of thing. 40-foot moth crashes into lighthouse. Monster bug couldn't resist glowing beacon. As the title of his book promised, Salinas presented readers with a world of marvels, some pleasing, but mostly horrific. In Germany, the nocturnal traveler could depend on luminous birds to light his way through the forest. In Ethiopia, a vague term referring to any place from Senegal to Sri Lanka, lived ants the size of mastiffs that used their claws for digging gold. Egypt was subject to periodic invasion by vast flights of winged serpents, against which the vigilant ibis was its only defense. In India dwelt the cruel manticore, a lion with a scorpion's tail and the face of a human, which seeketh most greedily after man's flesh. The natural world, as Salinas presented it, was deeply polarized. Some animals were intuitively sensitive to human needs and properly submissive in serving them, while others, like the manticore, lived chiefly to rip human flesh, which also took strange and monstrous forms. Despite the utterly anthropocentric character of the world as Salinas saw it, the boundary between humans and animals was confused, as it remains for us today. Salinas populated distant nations with cynocephali, or dog-headed humans, and with headless people called blemmies, whose faces were incorporated into their chests. Such marvels no doubt found an eager audience, in part because of their storybook quality. In time, Salinas and his book alike became known simply as Polyhistor, the teller of many tales. But unlikely, as it may seem to modern readers, Salinas endured for a millennium because people also believed what he wrote, and they wanted to believe it. Strange creatures out of Salinas thus turn up repeatedly, not just in fables, but on sober world maps, and not just through the medieval period, but well into the age of exploration. He provided the stock images to which the lazier map illustrators returned even into the 1700s, as in the Jonathan Swift verse, "So geographers in Afric maps with savage pictures fill their gaps." One such stock image, found for instance in the Nuremberg Chronicles of 1493, were the sciopods, or shadefoots, a swift but single-footed race of humans who dealt with the midday equatorial sun by flopping onto their backs and raising their huge feet overhead as parasols. When early explorers didn't actually find sciopods or manticores where Salinas and subsequent writers put them, wishful mapmakers simply moved these figures farther out into terra incognita. Thus did Salinas persist on the strength of what Rabelais later characterized as beautiful lies. He persisted in part, I think, because he tapped a genuine and badly underrated human emotion about the natural world. Salinas understood that nature scares a lot of us silly. And this is one reason he caught my attention, not just that evening, squatting by the fire, but afterward, as I thought about what I hoped to accomplish with this book. Salinas seemed to me to be a useful antidote, albeit an extreme one, to the fuzzier, one-with-the-universe attitudes of our day. Let me be more explicit about this, at the risk of saying good things about a very bad book, and incidentally of appearing to be a throwback. Despite the efforts of many earnest and life-affirming people to persuade me that the vampire bat is our friend, and that Native Americans enjoyed true harmony with Brother Wolf, I've never quite overcome the gut feeling that fear of nature is normal, more normal, certainly, than the love of it. Or perhaps I should say that fear and love are thoroughly tangled together. We've evolved over hundreds of thousands of years as hunter-gatherers, not as office workers, and our genes are still encoded with all the alarm signals that were appropriate when we lived among lions. We like to pretend these feelings don't exist, or that they're leftovers from so far back in our collective history as to have dwindled to imperceptible faintness. But even in Europe, Homo sapiens dwelt side by side with lions until about AD 200. Hippos once lived as far north as England, and rhinos appear in the cave paintings at Lascaux, on the border of France and Spain, from 12,000 BC. Only a few generations ago, grizzly bears ranged from California to Ohio, and wolves roamed on Cape Cod. In the course of my research for this book, I once hiked out into an open meadow in Yellowstone National Park looking for grizzly bears. Instead, I wandered too close to a small herd of impassive bison, which I regarded with indifference until one of them took offense, glowered, and came rolling toward me. It was less a charge than a warning, but oh, how my Pleistocene heart surged! In his book, The Way of the Animal Powers, Joseph Campbell describes how, even after generations of laboratory rearing, newly hatched chickens run for shelter if a hawk passes overhead, but they ignore gulls and other unthreatening birds. He wonders if such archaic genetic codes also sleep within us, from our long evolution among woolly mammoths and cave bears. We react with alarm, for instance, to the mere shape of snakes or spiders, though it may have been thousands of years since either represented a serious threat in our daily lives. Campbell quotes Wordsworth on the origin of our souls in God, from whom we arrive trailing clouds of glory. But the paleontological evidence is that our life star's other setting was also earthly and left us trailing clouds of fear. The fear of nature is not only normal, it can also be pleasurable. One reason I spend much of my time writing about the natural world, and particularly about the animals in this book, is that nature gives me the creeps, and the more I learn, the creepier and more wonderful it gets. There really are plenty of terrible things out there to tremble about. Not winged serpents and manticores, of course, and not even grizzly bears or great white sharks either, at least not in the conventional sense. No, I'd better take that back. Any time I dip a toe in the habitat of either one, I feel a tingling awareness that this might just be the one fluky time a human gets ripped to little sushi strips. What I really find creepy and wonderful about nature are not its great terrors, but its weird, unsuspected minutiae, its intricate workings painstakingly developed over millions of years of evolution, its minor horrors. For instance, that some sharks practice sibling cannibalism in the womb, or that a mole will paralyze earthworms, ball them up in a knot, and seal them away in individual cells in the walls of its chambered mound, still living, to be eaten at leisure. I'm captivated by the sight of a keyhole limpet on the rocks off British Columbia being attacked by a sea star. The limpet protects itself by lifting its mantle up over its shell, exposing a smooth surface on which the sea star can't get a grip. But the limpet also carries a sort of vicious pet under its shell, like an old lady's lapdog. And if the sea star persists, this pet, actually a small worm, reaches out and nips chunks of flesh from the assailant's feet. Nature fascinates and horrifies me in equal and directly proportionate measure, and I like to keep a respectful distance. It seems to me that the modern world, in full retreat from the fang and claw nightmares of the past, tries too hard to do the opposite, to be cool about the natural world when our hearts are quaking, to exhibit healthy scientific attitudes like kids in a junior high school sex education class. I think of David Attenborough purveying ecological dogma sotto voce, while very nearly sitting in a gorilla's lap, or of a woman I once watched pluck a tree boa from a branch in a Peruvian rainforest and wrap it around her forearm as if it were a bracelet from Bloomingdale's. There's something a little patronizing in this commonplace swim-with-the-dolphins mentality. We're in danger of turning what's left of the planet into a petting zoo. Aldous Huxley once wrote that 19th-century English romanticism about nature was possible only because the dark and terrifying forests had been cut down and the landscape opened up. All those broad axes made the Lake District safe for Wordsworth. Similarly, our benevolence toward wilderness, while appropriate to our times, is a measure of how much more thoroughly the wilderness has been subdued, and of our urbanized distance from it. The catalogue of horrors put forward by Salinas is, in contrast, a testimony to nature's strength. One reads it with a sense of nostalgia for the sound of wilderness still scratching and howling just outside Europe's garden gate. Salinas reminded me that what's missing from our attitude toward nature is a modicum of healthy terror. That said, it must immediately be added that as a writer about natural history, Gaius Julius Salinas was an utter booby, the embodiment of everything the worst popular writers about natural history have ever done wrong. His unfailing instinct was to reach for the best story, rather than sifting through the lore for something like truth. Even in Italy itself, Salinas apparently didn't fear that bane of beautiful lies, the skeptical and inquiring reader. In Calabria, he wrote, "Boas sucked milk from cows and laid waste the countryside. Italian wolves were endowed with a very fine tail hair that hath the power of love in it, if only the ardent youth could pluck one from the living animal. The urine of the Italian lynx congealed into an amber stone, dubbed lynx piss by the 16th century English translator, which was endowed with magnetic powers. But the lynx was so spiteful it swept dirt over its leavings to prevent them from being turned to human profit." Salinas appears never to have wasted a minute studying a real animal or plant. He was a grammarian. He studied texts, and particularly one text, Pliny's 37-volume Natural History. In his Collection of Remarkable Facts, Salinas made 1,150 unacknowledged borrowings from Pliny, a prodigious average of a half dozen plagiarisms per page. Hence his nickname, Pliny's Ape. His program, in one critic's scathing view, was to extract the dross and leave the gold from Pliny's not altogether unscientific work, producing the most completely miraculous view of the world ever put forward in Europe. The pity in this was that Pliny himself was an eager student of nature, so much so that he died from the fumes while observing the eruption of Mount Vesuvius at close range. So if I share with Salinas the universal human fear of nature and also a fondness for its remarkable facts, I've labored to be sure my facts are real, and wherever possible, I've gone out to see them for myself in the field. In the course of writing this book, I've traveled to observe different species in England, Scotland, Ireland, Ecuador, Panama, Peru, Bermuda, the Bahamas, and among other U.S. locations, California, Connecticut, Florida, Maine, New York, Vermont, and Wyoming. I've gone to these places not just to see the animals, but also to meet the people who know them best, a mix of biologists, hunters, hobbyists, animal trainers, and conservationists. For me, these travels have been a great pleasure, occasionally uncomfortable, but almost always enlightening. The people who actually spend their lives in the field, observing the animals, would probably say the same thing for themselves. But like Pliny, they seem often to have paid a heavy price for their love of nature, including meager salaries, minimal professional recognition. Academic advancement occurs in inverse proportion to time spent in the field. Troubled marriages, and such colorful medical disorders as malaria, encephalitis, bubonic plague, filariasis, leishmaniasis, hepatitis, botflies, arboviruses, giardiases, worms, amoebas, and assorted bites and stings. One of the researchers described in this book was suffering from an unidentified tropical virus when I visited with him, and has since dropped out of biological research. Another saw his wife killed in a fiery accident at their field station. Two researchers, each carrying in his mind an irreplaceable library of knowledge about the natural world, flew into a cloud forest mountaintop and died. In choosing to write about these people, and to see the animals as much through their eyes as my own, I have, like Salinas, written an anthropocentric book. Purists may object that the lives of the animals merit consideration entirely on their own, and I wouldn't disagree with them. For instance, the improbable discovery that 500-pound grizzly bears choose to spend the month of August in the mountains of Wyoming, feeding almost exclusively on moths, gets us nowhere from a practical point of view. It's merely a remarkable fact, and the idea that the natural world is full of a million such lovely paradoxical facts, most of them still undiscovered or even unimaginable, ought to be sufficient. We shouldn't need to argue for preserving grizzly habitat because grizzlies produce economic benefits through ecotourism. Or because grizzlies may contain something in their genetic code that may someday, somehow, prove useful for human survival. A sense of wonder at the strange workings of evolution should be enough. But there's also room, it seems to me, to wonder at the strange workings of our own engagement with the natural world. Beneath the modern scientific attitude toward nature, our undercurrent of lore about animals runs almost as strong as it did for Salinas, or for the Neolithic hunters who painted the murals by torchlight in the cave at Lascaux. About the group of weasels known as stoats, for example, I've been enthusiastically informed that they suck blood, can hypnotize rabbits, carry their dead home in a funeral cortege, and sometimes conceive a grudge against a human so strong that they will scrabble against a window glass in a vampirish frenzy to get at the victim within. It's unwise to be smug about Salinas because people are always going to need the kind of lore about the natural world, the mix of wonder and dread, attraction and repulsion that he provided. It's human nature, and I don't mean that to convey any hint of regret. Animals are the source of some of our most imaginative and persistent fantasies, and these fantasies are the only way most of us ever get to escape from our urbanized and domesticated lives into a larger world. Not long ago, I read a Seamus Heaney poem in which he accomplishes the miraculous feat of writing a tender love poem to his wife by likening her to a skunk. It's a poem about a man on the road in California, lonely for home, visited at night by a skunk in the backyard. And there she was, the intent and glamorous, ordinary, mysterious skunk, mythologized, demythologized, snuffing the boards 5 feet beyond me. The writer eventually goes home and forgets the skunk until, as he tells his wife, "It all came back to me last night, stirred by the sootfall of your things at bedtime, your head down, tail up, hunt in a bottom drawer for the black plunge-line nightdress." It's surely an eccentric poem, but also lovely, and it reminded me how much we need to keep the threads of tenderness and savagery alive in our vision of the natural world. These threads run with special vividness through the lives of the people I've chosen to write about, though they might perhaps deny it. The scientific researchers in particular work under a burdensome obligation to regard nature with clinical dryness, devoid of emotion or anthropomorphism. By inclination, most of the characters in this book are also down to earth. They would say they're just trying to make a living, muddle through, get by. Ted Parker, one of the most remarkable ornithologists of this century, once told me that he started to memorize bird songs as a child simply because it was a way to impress the little old ladies in his Lancaster, Pennsylvania birding club. By the time I met him, in his mid-30s, he'd memorized the songs of more than 4,000 neotropical bird species and often knew multiple calls for each species. Birdsong was language for him. Shamans on their mystical bird flights into the other world could have no more profound a connection with the animal spirits. Much as he might claim to be just a guy in high-top Converse sneakers looking for a pickup basketball game, it was clear that Parker had been singled out and anointed by nature, albeit in the person of a few elderly women in a Pennsylvania suburb. Likewise, nature could hardly have been more explicit in choosing David Wingate, the Bermuda conservationist. When he was just 12 years old, a tidal wave trapped him and his dog on a sandy hillock, and I realized, Christ, I'm on an island! And then the water receded. The darker threads of our engagement with the natural world also run through the lives of everyone in this book. There is, for instance, no one who loves snapping turtles or identifies with them as much as does John Rogers. But he's a turtle hunter by profession. I spend the whole week with turtles. It's just me and them, me and the snappers against the world. And then what do? I take them into the cities and the suburbs, and I sell them. I'm selling my friends. And it's always the same feeling. The truck's going to be empty, and I'll be alone again. The flip side of healthy terror, a primordial loathing for things that are different from us, a powerful impulse to destroy the encroaching natural world, can at times seize hold of anyone. Once, over too many large cervezas on some backwater of the Amazon, a biologist told me that as a boy, he used to make popsicle stick constructions. But they weren't rafts or other commonplace playthings. Instead, he created an upright framework in which he mounted a single-edge razor blade with a lead weight on top, creating a guillotine through which he put any snake he could catch. As an adult, perhaps to compensate, he was making a living by defending animals from inhumane treatment. His life represented an extreme transformation. But we all have such shameful memories. I can still hear the sound of a turtle's skull that I crushed under a stone as a child. And if we never face the dark side of our connection to the natural world, we'll never understand nature itself. In the end, my intention has been to see both people and animals as they are, not to homogenize them, not to make them merely nice, not above all, to turn animals into petting zoo creatures so we can feel good about ourselves when we protect them. Which brings me back to Salinas. If his collection of remarkable facts plainly wasn't looking at the real world, neither were his readers over the next millennium, and this disinclination to question, to explore, to rely on what their own senses might have told them may be the hardest thing for modern readers to fathom. How did accepted wisdom triumph so thoroughly over experiment, over experience, even over reality? Roman writers of Salinas's day typically tried to cite as many notable authors as possible, and they bequeathed to the Middle Ages the naive idea that the one who could assemble the greatest number of authorities on a subject was himself the most reliable authority. The apparent comprehensiveness of all those endlessly cited sources, the sheer pedantic dead weight, smothered any urge to do original research. "For what can we challenge properly for our own," wrote Salinas, with a hapless intellectual shrug, "since the diligence of men in old time hath been such that nothing hath remained untouched unto our days." Through this sort of uncritical repetition, European knowledge about the natural world underwent a transformation that T.H. White has likened to the nursery game Russian telephones, in which children whisper a message from ear to ear, and what started out as Nanny thinks this game is fun comes out in the end as Granny wants an Uzi gun. Thus one Roman moralizer mistranslated from a Greek original and ascribed to the shark, Galeos, the supposed reproductive habits of the weasel, Gale. Real animals were beside the point as the game of Russian telephones proceeded through the Middle Ages. After Salinas, almost all of the players were Christians. The church, with its developing preference for dogma rather than individual perception, readily took up the Roman regard for authority, even certain pagan authorities like Salinas. But where Salinas distorted reality in the cause of entertainment, the church distorted it as a way of disclosing Christian truth. What mattered, St. Augustine wrote, wasn't whether certain animals actually existed so much as what they signified. Thus, the most completely miraculous view of the world ever put forward in Europe found its ideal readership. The Western world decided that it could get by with a grab bag of ideas about nature and for centuries turned its back on nature itself. All this is worth thinking about now because the world seems once again to be turning its back on reality, shutting nature out. We want to preserve our animals, but only in isolation, separate from our everyday lives. We want rainforests as a day trip from a first-class hotel. We want rampant elephants as the raw material for a Discovery Channel documentary. But Kenya has proposed fencing in its elephants, and in Botswana's last great wilderness, the Okavango Delta, where I squatted by the fire and contemplated Pleistocene memories, more than 900 miles of cattle fencing have been erected in the past few years, cutting off old migration routes and killing wildebeests and giraffes. The dull generalists of the animal world, the mallards and mute swans, are everywhere in the ascendant. The stranger, more idiosyncratic species are vanishing or locked up in zoos. We have no shortage of entertaining new mythologies to substitute for this bland reality. From Tamagotchi cyber pets to the extraterrestrials in endless movies of the Mars Attacks genre. In coastal Ecuador, where Ted Parker and I were watching one of the last precious remnants of rainforest being cut down around us, the landowner visited one day to check on the progress of the chainsaws. His young son came with him, wearing a teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles t-shirt. Raphael, Donatello, Leonardo, and Michelangelo lived, and the kid was undoubtedly oblivious to the far more bizarre, more combative, more radical life being erased forever before his eyes. It's possible that that unfortunate kid and the rest of us can get by with such substitutes, much as the Middle Ages got by with Salinas. But we shouldn't have to. We're fortunate to live in an age of discovery. Because of people like Parker and Wingate and many others in this book, we know that the world is full of life forms that are too strange, too beautiful, too powerfully disturbing to let merely vanish. We can celebrate before it's too late all the strange and wonderful things biologists are learning about how the natural world really works and all the oddball creatures they continue to discover. We can actually choose between wilderness and the petting zoo world. We can accept an artificial future in which all creatures great and small, or the prettier ones anyway, are preserved and safely packaged for tourists and television viewers. Or we open the gates and stand back, as God ordered Noah to do in Genesis. Bring forth with thee every living thing that is with thee, of all flesh, and of every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth, that they may be fruitful and multiply upon the earth. We can preserve for ourselves and for its own sake a world of remarkable facts as entertaining as anything in Salinas, indeed more compelling than anything he could ever have imagined. Only this time, the creatures are real. If our vision of this world is good enough, maybe the third millennium, unlike the first, will not have to make do on fantasy alone. Days of Torpor, Nights of Sloth. The first time I saw a sloth, in a small and sparsely furnished cage at the National Zoo in Washington, D.C., it took me several moments to spot the thing, a motionless blob of fur clinging to a bare tree branch. "It's a fake," a teenager advised me. "Fake something or other. There are two of them." "They're gorillas," another teenager ventured. "Little baby gorillas." "Then how come they don't move?" said the first teenager. The second teenager consulted the small sign posted in a corner. "Maybe it's a leaf-nosed bat," he said, reading the name of a species said to be in residence. But the idea of a bat the size of a small dog, and leaf-nosed to boot, was so unsettling that after a brief pause, all of us descended as one on the sign. "Oh!" said the second teenager. "They're sloths." "What? Those big ugly things?" "Yeah, it says right here. Two-toed sloths." Full of doubt, his companion replied, "I thought sloths were supposed to be extinct." Pity the sloth. It's an animal perpetually misunderstood and reviled by the human species. These inoffensive mammals, which pass most of their lives 30 to 90 feet up in the rainforests of Central and South America, have been called normal morons, chronic pacifists, and even hanging animal baskets. Georges-Louis Buffon, the 18th century naturalist, listed among their chief attributes slowness, stupidity, and habitual pain, and added that with even a single additional defect, sloths would cease to exist. Indeed, the sloth's very name is a deadly sin. Says the Bible, "Slothfulness casteth into a deep sleep, and an idle soul shall suffer hunger." But there's a paradox here. The sloth truly enjoys a deep sleep, 10 to 14 hours a day, and it is by definition idle. Some sloths are so lethargic as to be utterly unmoved by gunshots at close range, or by the presence of cats, eagles, or other common predators. And yet, sloths survive, lazing in the upper branches of the jungle, while quicker, keener, more industrious animals around them fall victim in the daily struggle. As to hunger, the sloth's stomach is disproportionately large. Together with its contents, it may make up a quarter to a third of the animal's weight. And it's usually full. Sloths have the good sense to survive largely on leaves, and the supply is abundant. They don't often suffer hunger. The sloth is, in short, an affront to all our notions about the predatory jungle and about life itself. Shortly after my zoo visit, in search of a somewhat more informed point of view on these enigmatic creatures, I traveled to one of the places they call home, Barro, Colorado Island in Panama. There are probably 10 or more sloths in every hectare, or 4 or more per acre, on this island reserve, which is maintained by the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute. But naturalists may work for months without noticing one. An exception is Bonifacio de Leon, known to other naturalists on the island as Boney, who'd been described to me as possessing an almost supernatural ability to locate sloths. I found him at his workbench with the skulls of monkeys and three-toed sloths hanging from monofilament overhead. He agreed to take me on his morning tour, and after he'd put on a silver hard hat and taped his pant legs shut at the ankles, as a precaution against ticks, we set off. 5 yards into the forest, he stopped, pointed, and said, "Perezoso." Panamanians call the sloth gato perezoso, or lazy cat. When it became apparent that I could see nothing, Boney seized me by the shoulders and fixed me at the proper angle of vision. Still nothing. He plunged into the undergrowth, and I followed him 50 feet in, past a dozen substantial intervening trees. Just as he was about to start climbing, I discerned a 3-toed sloth 60 feet up. At that moment, it was scratching its butt, rather ineffectively. Back on the trail, Boney pointed out an assortment of wildlife, with which he communicated by sucking noisily on his wrist, by smacking his lips against his fist, and by humming on a torn-off piece of leaf. Some of the creatures he addressed were visible: a parrot, a toucan, an anteater. Some were merely audible, the capuchin monkeys crashing through the treetops. A few, the sloths, seemed neither visible nor audible. Boney helped me in my obtuseness. When I failed to perceive a 2-toed sloth sleeping 50 feet up in a hammock of vines, he picked out 2 vines hanging down from the canopy and hauled on them like a bell ringer in a church tower. The sloth stirred and became apparent, moving off like an upside-down cat that's slightly peeved at being disturbed. Perezoso, Boney explained. I consoled myself with the thought that even Gene Montgomery, then a vertebrate ecologist at the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute, had a hard time spotting sloths. Throughout the 1970s, Montgomery and a colleague, Mel Sunquist, conducted the first methodical study of sloths in their native environment. The two of them, and sometimes Boney too, climbed trees to capture animals for observation, fed glass beads to captives to measure digestive flow, strapped radio collars on free-roaming individuals, tucked mini-transmitters up the animals' backsides, and otherwise arrived at a detailed knowledge of the sloths of Barro, Colorado Island. Studying sloths requires patience above all. Watching them in action has been likened to reading War and Peace. But in Montgomery, I didn't find the phlegmatic, professorial doctor sloth I'd been expecting. He arrived to meet me outside his office in Panama City at the wheel of a battered 4-wheel drive vehicle. Solidly built and ruddy-skinned, he wore a great walrus mustache and a characteristic facial expression of roguish glee. The first point he wanted to make about sloths, almost before we sat down, was that they are nice animals. Or rather, 3-toed sloths are nice anyway. The distinction matters, as he soon explained. The 5 species of sloth fall into 2 genera, whose scientific names are bradipus, which means slow-footed, and calipus, which means crippled. Montgomery pulled out a cardboard box full of animal bones in plastic bags. "That one's an anteater," he said, throwing a bag back and continuing his search. When he'd found suitable specimens, he demonstrated that the 2 sloth genera can be distinguished by the number of hook-like claws on their forelimbs. Hence, the common names 2 and 3-toed sloths. They are as different, he said, as cats and dogs. 2-toed sloths, like the blobs of fur I'd seen in the zoo, are far and away the livelier genus. Compared with other mammals, 2-toed sloths may seem dazed or drugged. But 3-toed sloths, in action, can be compared only with plants, and even then, kudzu may be quicker. They move as if put into a trance and then filmed in slow motion. Indeed, Montgomery's predecessors in sloth research didn't require radio telemetry. To test the mobility of the 3-toed sloth in the wild, naturalist Hermann Turler placed a plastic bowl on an animal's head one night. It was still there in the morning. Another time, he briefly kept a 3-toed sloth as a pet. "One evening," he wrote, "we suddenly smelled something like a burning sloth, the odor coming from the neighboring room. The animal was half asleep on a large electric bulb, with its rear going up in smoke. And according to Turler, it wanted to stay there." While climbing 90-foot-tall trees, some of them too thick for a safety belt, Montgomery understandably came to prize the 3-toed sloth for its immobility. It was a relatively easy matter to reach out with a noose at the end of an extension pole, pluck the animal from its perch, and lower it to the ground. Close encounters at that altitude were also not unpleasant. Even if a three-toed sloth were to rouse itself to attack, the only creature slow enough to suffer its bite would be another three-toed sloth. In any case, said Montgomery, it has no incisors, and its bite is no worse than a somewhat leathery kiss. The two-toed sloth, on the other hand, has sharp canine teeth and can make itself very unpleasant when threatened. Hissing, it swings an arm out to hook an adversary and draw it in toward its mouth. Montgomery showed me a knuckle on his hand that was once cut to the bone in this fashion. As if being bitten by a sloth were not embarrassing enough, he noted with chagrin that the animal was under sedation at the time. The two-toed sloth is also quick enough to run away when provoked. Montgomery recalled afternoons in which he climbed one 90-foot tree only to have his quarry escape to the next tree over, then climbed that tree only to have the sloth escape to a third tree, and so on until the air was fairly blue with strong language. Radio tracking showed that two-toed sloths also do a considerable amount of traveling through the trees without provocation. Unlike three-toed sloths, they're strictly nocturnal, and on their nightly ramblings, they may use their canine teeth to raid birds' nests. In captivity, they also eat fruits and vegetables. I suggested to Montgomery that if one compared the two kinds of sloths, it might seem that the three-toed genus is more primitive, a less advanced life form. Not only is its lifestyle one of more profound torpor, but as Buffon suggested, it seems fragile, on the verge of extinction. No one's ever managed to keep a three-toed sloth alive in captivity on any diet. Montgomery regarded my suggestion balefully. On the contrary, he said, it was possible to argue that the more active genus is, in a sense, less perfectly adapted to its environment. The lazier, less aggressive three-toed sloth has advanced further into the sweet ecological niche of slothfulness. Every feature of these animals has evolved to make a leaf-eating, tree-dwelling life easier. Besides being hard to reach, leaves are also difficult to break down into useful nutrients. Their single virtue is their abundance. To exploit this resource, both two- and three-toed sloths had to make compromises, and it might well be said that they gave up everything else in exchange for a permanent meal ticket. Muscle, for example. Maintaining muscle bulk requires more energy than a sloth can easily extract from leaves, so it gets by on about half the usual amount. The two-toed sloth weighs about 10 pounds, the three-toed just 7, and only about a quarter of their body weight is muscle. Low body weight is an advantage. It allows the sloth to climb out on the slenderest branches, where it can harvest leaves at a leisurely pace, safely beyond the reach of most predators. But lack of muscle is also the reason sloths are so slothful. They simply don't have what it takes to go any faster. On the ground, where they seldom travel, sloths drag themselves along on their bellies. I saw several animals attempting this in captivity on a concrete surface, and they looked like men dying in the desert just short of the waterhole. But hanging under a branch requires little energy, especially as sloths can lock their hook-like claws in place and concentrate on the more important business of sleeping and eating. Their grip is so tenacious that, according to myth, they remain hanging in place even after death. At times, for want of an easier way to bring down a sloth, Montgomery had to saw off the branch to which the animal was attached. South American Indians who eat sloths sometimes bring them home in this fashion, with the branch over a shoulder and the sloth hanging off the end, riding indolently to its doom. Immobility is otherwise a virtue for sloths. Their stillness makes them harder to see, and not being seen is really their best form of defense. All their extremities are adapted to crop the maximum area of surrounding leaves with the least possible movement. For example, said Montgomery, other mammals, even giraffes, have 7 vertebrae in their necks. He showed me the skeleton of a three-toed sloth. It had 9. The three-toed sloth can bury its pestle-like head and neck in its chest, or swing it back perpendicular to the spine to get it leaves behind its head. It can also rotate its head through three quarters of a circle, and it does so regularly. One of the sloths Boney showed me on Barro Colorado kept looking slowly from side to side like a bewildered child in bottle-bottom glasses. Having settled into a verdant spot with food all around, sloths do not, however, gorge themselves. They masticate slowly, and according to one source, take in only about 1/7 as much sustenance as a young fawn of the same weight. In its quest to remain unnoticed, the sloth benefits not just from its immobility, but also from its excellent natural camouflage. As my instinct for sloths became keener during my stay on Barro, Colorado, I spotted one sitting in the crotch of a tree, arms folded across its chest, patiently waiting for nearby buds to burgeon. It resembled nothing more animate than a nest or a bunch of dead leaves. But as if this weren't enough, I noticed that its pelt had a greenish tinge that blended in with the foliage. Montgomery later explained that three species of algae grow in its grooved, gray-brown hairs. After immobility, the sloth's other great adaptation to leafy life is its gut. The 18th-century Irish author Oliver Goldsmith described the sloth as the meanest and most ill-formed of all those animals that chew the cud. In fact, chewing the cud would take far too much energy to be of any value to a sloth. Instead, it allows the bacteria in its multi-chambered, ruminant-like stomach to do the work of breaking down cellulose into energy. No other animal devotes so great a portion of its bulk to digestion. One researcher described the sloth to me as simply a big chemical factory, a fermentation chamber that moves around in the trees. Despite the size of its stomach, the sloth digests, need one say the word, slowly. It's a very regular animal. Montgomery and Sundquist found that three-toed sloths defecate and urinate approximately once every 8 days, two-toed sloths slightly more often. This lethargic digestion may be due to the animal's inability to maintain a constant body temperature. It ranges from a high of 91 degrees Fahrenheit to as little as 75, and when the temperature drops to its daily low point, its chemical factory may simply shut down. The sloth's toilet habits are remarkable. Its excreta are almost odorless and would probably not betray the animal's presence if merely dropped to the ground from 50 feet up. But when nature calls...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.